Okay, really excited to welcome our guest Leo today for the first external speaker in the Pulse Seminar Series. Leo's from across the lake at MSR. He's one of the primary authors of the Z3 SMT solver, which I know many of us have written papers against. And he's going to talk to us today about some work in a new proof assistant called Lean.
Thank you very much. Thank you for the invitation. I'm super excited to be here. I want to give a short introduction to Lean in this talk and talk a little bit about automation independent type theory, the main challenges, and how we are trying to attack this problem. A lot of people are helping. I mean, Lean would not exist without all these people here. They're actively helping building the libraries and the prover itself, right? And also, we have to thank all these people here. I mean, most of us in the previous slide didn't know anything about dependency type theory before we started. And without people in these slides, Lean would also not exist. I mean, they were super helpful. And some of them are scared now. When we find them, we keep asking questions. They hide from us. Okay, what is Lean? Lean is a new open source theorem prover, right? We want it to be a platform for software verification development, right? A platform for formalizing mathematics. One application we have is education in mind. I mean, Lean has been used already for two courses at CMU, one about theorem proving in type theory, and another one, introduction to logic, right, was taught. I mean, the nice thing about these courses is that they are self-contained. I mean, the students can go to a website, and all exercises and examples are live. You can go there and try the examples, and Lean is running inside of your browser in this case. The student doesn't need to install anything. It's quite convenient. And that's another thing that we also, I mean, next semester we are going to try at CMU Math Concepts course. It's going to be only one class. It is an undergraduate course. Only one class is going to have the interactive version. And we'll see what will happen. In Stanford, we also plan for next year to have the discrete math course. One student there already went over all the lecture notes and made sure that you can express every exercise in the lecture notes inside of Lean. And the idea is that one day, the online version of this course is going to be available, and you can check all the exercises without any human interaction, right? Lean, we also want it to be a platform for people interested in doing synthesis, right? We really believe in the algebraic principle, right? That you have a small trusted kernel, right? That people can write new reference type checkers for Lean. It should be easy. Around less than 2,000 lines of code, you should be able to write a checker for Lean proofs that were created by the main system. It has expressive logic, and it supports partial constructions. The idea that the user can leave holes that should be synthesized automatically by the system. We also wanted, like Z3, right, to make Lean, Lean is not just a system, but also can be used as a library that can be embedded in bigger systems. For instance, Joe Hendricks from Galois is a company in Oregon, implemented a Haskell API for Lean. You can now write Haskell code to access the terms, you can import libraries, you can create your own terms, you can type check them, everything from Haskell. Right. They want to use Lean like as a glue for if you're verifying something with a set solver, you use writing rules using the Lean itself. You combine many things, you can glue everything together as a big proof term. And you create this proof term using the Haskell API. As I said, we had two courses already at CMU. Lean is far from being done. It's a work in progress, right? It's a long term effort, right? Don't expect it to be done anytime soon. We are always improving it, adding, looking for collaborators, right? But the main goal is to bring together two worlds, right? The world of interactive theorem provers like Koch and Isabel, right? They are the most famous interactive theorem provers. And the work of automated reasoning tools like Z3, CVC4, vampire. There are theorem provers that are completely automatic. They are for more restrictive logics, like for sure logic or propositional logic, right? But they are completely automatic. Our main goal is to bridge the gap between these two worlds. But we also have many secondary goals, right? Robust proofs is a main thing, right? I mean, many of the projects, at Microsoft Z3 is used as basically you can have two big sets. I mean, in one set, you have users that are doing number crunching, right? They are solving constraints. There is some tool that creates a huge formula, for instance, for doing test case generation to find security vulnerabilities. Usually, you have this program that's creating a huge formula, right? And Z3 is going to crunch. It's like a number crunching engine, right? And there's the other case where people are trying to verify something. Right, in these fragments, you have tools like Daphne, F-star, the verify C compiler. You're trying to prove things. And in this case, one property you want is robust proofs. What's a robust proof? It's a proof that you make a tiny change, right, that is completely irrelevant. You want your proofs to be able to still to prove that. But this doesn't happen in practice. When the complexity is too high, you're facing an undecidable problem. The theorem prover is full of heuristics, right? And some of these heuristics, they are brittle, right? And since the system is completely automatic, the user cannot influence directly the system, right? It can only influence in indirect ways. In Lean, we want to solve this problem by bridging the gap between interactive and automated worlds. If a proof is not robust, you can give a skeleton, you can give parts of the proof to the system. And only the parts that are completely obvious, you let the number crunching engine do its job. We want a kernel to be minimalist and high performance, right? You want it to be useful, a system that's useful for having these interactive courses I told you about, right? And our main one goal that we think that is we want to push is that proving should be as easy as programming, right? I make the point that I meet all the time high school students that are great programmers, right? I believe they are great because they learn by themselves, right? By trial and error, right? You can get a compiler, you can hack it, play with it, and you can learn everything. Sometimes I meet high school guys that are better than really hardcore developers. But it's really hard for math. It's really hard to find a high school student that is a great in mathematics if he didn't have a mentor, someone. Maybe it's informal education this student had, but he had someone that helped him to understand math, to tell him what is a good proof, what is a bad proof. Because it's like a process that's almost by osmosis, right? Someone keeps telling you what's a good proof, what's a bad proof, and you keep refining until you develop in your head your own style. But we want to have a platform where students could hack not just programs, but also proofs, right?
A quick question on that.
So normally the proofs that we write for proof assistance are not fit for human consumption. And so I think when you're talking about somebody becoming like a great math hacker, is it the goal that the proofs that we write in Lean will be the kind of mathematical proofs I'd also want to read on paper? Or
yes.
And maybe the skeleton will help with that? Or how does
In Koch, I agree, and maybe Lean, but there's some systems like Isabel are going to this direction, right? They are much more declarative. You state what the intermediate steps, the level of interaction is by stating intermediate steps. And each step is proved automatically by some automation, right? The gap between each step is what you have to work on, but ideally these proofs are very robust. Basically, the proofs are sequences of statements, right? Like a math proof saying you have this, then you have that, and you have this, and so on. It's like a sequence. Nobody tells you how to get from the previous step to the next one, right? This is the kind of level of interaction you want to achieve, right? Would be great. I mean, I think we can declare success if you never have to remember a name of a previous theorem you have proved, right? This is the kind of thing we want. You have to remember the language you're talking about. You have to remember about, if you're working with polynomials, you have to know about addition, multiplication, and so on, right? But you don't have to remember the name of the theorems, right? In Microsoft, you have both, you have many projects in software verification and also many projects in formalizing mathematics. I learned some of the, I listed some of them here, right? None of them, I'm not trying to imply they have been done using Lean. Lean didn't even exist before these projects were performed, right? They have been, people have used the Boogie Tree stack or Coq. Basically, the software verification ones were done using the Boogie Tree stack, and the formalized mathematics have been done using Coq. But why did I list these projects? Because they have many similar problems, right? Proof stability is one problem there. Libraries are big, right? You have to remember the name of theorems, the name of functions, right? Scalability issues in both of them, right? I mean, EZ3, I don't need to tell you that we have scalability issues. I receive these buggy performance problems all the time. But for Coq, I mean, George Gontier, that's a colleague of mine that led the formalized mathematics projects at Microsoft, he had many scalability issues, right? At the point that he had to ask for features to be implemented in Coq to be able to, for him to finish his work. One thing that we keep trying to push formalized mathematics to mathematicians, but we have to remember that the same problems we have in software engineering, they will have, right? If this becomes, if formalized mathematics is mainstream, and I think that's the direction we are going to, right? The complexity is increasing so much, we are going to need computer assistance, right? But this is the good story, computers can help us, but the bad part is that all the problems we have in software engineering, we are going to have in formalized mathematics, right? Bit rotting is the most common one, right? Software over time tends to get messier and messier. It's really hard to maintain a clean code base. What is new about Lean, right? We like to believe that we have a powerful elaboration engine, right? In any proof assistant, what you write is a far cry from the fully elaborated Theorem. Right. There are many gaps, many details that you don't type, that the system has to infer by itself. Right. This process of inferring the missing parts, we call elaboration. Right. In the elaboration includes many, many procedures, includes a high-order unification procedure. You have to handle definitional reductions, coercions, ad hoc polymorphism, that's also known as overloading, type classes, statics. You have lots of features that people expect in a proof assistance. We also want to synthesize obvious steps automatically, right? This is what what I meant here by elaboration engine. Our kernel is much smaller than the kernel of other proof assistants. I think only HoloLite is smaller than us, but HoloLite is for simply typed theories, not for dependence type theory, is also a simpler logic. Our kernel does not contain termination checker, fixed point operators, pattern matching, module management. All these features are outside of the kernel. We also, Lean was built with multi-core support in mind, right? We can compile theorems in parallel, right? This is quite useful when you're compiling a big library, right? And we also support fast incremental compilation. That was another feature that was built from the beginning, right? You can, Lean is going to save a cache file that it uses to do incremental compilation. When we make demos, I mean, we have an Emacs interface that's like an integrated development environment that keeps telling you the types of things, putting mistakes you have made. And someone thought that we had like a background process that's running on the background. There's no background process, right? It's the incremental compiler, right? That it is starting from scratch every time, not really from scratch, using the cache to the incremental compilation, right? And so the compilation is quite fast. And we want to support a mixed declarative and tactic proof style. Right? Tactic is more or less, I mean, many of you are familiar with Koch, where you instruct the theorem prover you should do that. You unfold this definition, apply this induction on this major premise. You apply this theorem. Everything is very imperative. The declarative style is the style that I was telling you, that you say, have this fact. You don't say how you get this fact, right? You just state that you should be able to prove that. It should be obvious from what you have you proved so far. This step should be obvious. And we have a strong focus on automation, right? I will talk about one example of automation, one procedure that we have implemented. Okay, but why dependency type theory, right? I don't want to make this talk about why dependency type theory is the way to go. I'm going to limit myself to say dependency type theory. I think personally that is really beautiful, right? But I can tell you from the engineering point of view, there are many advantages, right? You have a built-in computational interpretation for your terms, right? As a developer, you save a lot. For instance, is the same data structure that you use to represent terms, is the same data structure for representing proofs, right? You don't need to implement twice. For instance, in many systems, you're going to have some way to represent proofs, right? And one in a completely different data structure for representing terms. This is not needed, but these two things are the same in dependency type theory. And you can reuse a lot of code. For instance, we have implemented a compiler that you give to this compiler a set of recursive equations, and it's going to compile in the built-in primitives of lean. Right? You can use this compiler for writing recursive functions, but since there's no difference between proofs and terms, you automatically have a mechanism for doing proofs by induction. You can also use recursive equations for doing proofs by induction, right? And so you minimize the amount of codes you have to write as a developer. Mathematical structures, this is also is quite beautiful in dependency type theory because they are first class citizens, right? You can, like a group or a ring, they are first class citizens. You can have functions that take groups and returns groups, right? This is really nice. Even if you don't care about mathematics, you just replace mathematical structures by modules. Right, you can have a function that takes a module and returns another module, right? To end this, I mean, if you don't believe in dependency type theory, you want to learn more about it, I have two links here, right? In Praise of Dependency Types by Mike Schumann, right? And Type Inference in Mathematics by Jeremy Avigad, that works with me in the Lean project. And he's a mathematician, and he makes a strong point about using dependence type theory for formalizing mathematics. Architecture, right? Lean is essentially you should view it as a compiler, right? You have a parser, you have a preprocessor, you have the elaboration step, and in the end, you have the kernel that checks the fully elaborated term where all gaps have been filled by the elaborator. The elaborator has many, many steps, right? You're going to do coercion resolution, right? Mathematicians don't want to coerce an integer into a real number, right? This should be transparent. They expect these coercions to be introduced automatically. As a programmer, we also expect, right? When you're programming in C, we don't coerce manually an integer to a float, right? This happens automatically behind the scenes. We have type class resolution, high order unification, the compiler for recursive equations, the tactic framework that's the gateway for automation. This is where most of the code is in Lean. I mean, 90% of the project is the elaboration step and the different modules.
So we have to trust the elaborator?
No, you just have to trust the kernel.
So what if the elaborator just replaces my proof with true?
Yeah, you have. If you're concerned about that, you can write your own preprinter. I mean, you get the fully elaborated term. You can write a preprinter that you wrote yourself. In Lean, you can write, as I was mentioning, you can write your own type checker, So you don't have to trust our kernel. You can write your own type checker. But of course, someone can have replaced it, right? Then you write also your own preprinter, right? Something that's going to print the terms. And you only need to preprint the statements of the theorems, right? The proofs you may completely ignore, but you want to make sure that the statement was not replaced by true, right? Or some convoluted way of saying false implies whatever you want, right? Yes, I mean...
Sometimes you're right, I mean, on this point, and we don't need to go down the trusting trust and exact, you know, rat hole, but it would be nice to have a variant of a kernel that printed out the theorems that it had proven, right? Because then anything getting down to the kernel, you're not trusting, right? You're still trusting the printer, of course, and the rasterization on your screen and the graphics on there, blah, blah, blah. You know, the kernel says, this is what I did.
Yes. That's one, I mean, we have a reference type checker in Haskell. It's 1,500 lines of code. It includes a printer. I mean, it's a completely separate code base. It's a different code base. I mean, it's different programming language, and it has a printer there. I mean, of course, the printer is not as sophisticated as the one we have in the official system, but you, if someone wants to extend it, or they can, right? And that's the answer we have. I mean, for this kind of concern, that's a real concern. And as this, people sometimes say trust is not important, but it will eventually. It will really. For instance, one example was the flight check project. This that they did at CMU by Tom Hales. They hired people from I think was from. I forgot the country, I mean, but they hired a lot of external people for doing some of the proofs. You really want to make sure that they proved what you asked them to, right? They're not exploiting some bug in the type checker. That's scenarios where the trust is really important. Okay, the kernel. The link kernel is implemented in two layers, right? In the first layer, we have only dependent lambda calculus, and you have some options, right? I will talk more about that. Why do we have these options? In the second layer, we have inductive families, quotient types, and two kinds of high-order inductive types for homotopy type theory. I will talk more about that. But the picture I want to give it's important that you have the first layer, that you have dependence lambda calculus, right? Knowing support for inductive data types. On top of that, you can have extensions. Why did we implement it like that? Because you were experimenting with different flavors of dependence type theory, right? In the end, now, we maintain now only two flavors, right? The standard, right, that is good for, at least in my point of view, for soft engineering problems, for mathematics, everything undergrad, math, you can use the standard library, right? If you care about soft engineering, not just soft engineering, but engineering problems, you want analysis, multivariate analysis, the standard library is what you want, right? It is proofing relevant, right? It has a predicative prop, right? You can decide if you want to be classical or not. Right, I will talk more about that later. You have inductive types and quotient types, right? And we also have the hot version, the homotopy type theory version, right? That is proof relevance, right? Because it's a big thing in homotopy type theory, proof relevancy, right? You have the univalence axiom. You have you also have inductive families, but you have also higher inductive types, right? Although we support only these two libraries, it's not hard to create experimental versions, right? It's not really feasible for us to maintain all versions, right? But for instance, Steve Audi, a professor at CMU, he wants to play with a version of the kernel that has an impredicative universe that is proof relevant, right? He wants to make experiments with this setting. We like to say that I think everybody in the core link team is not. We are not constructive. We are not classical. We want to support both kinds of users, right? We believe computation is important, right? But both mathematicians are classical mathematicians, right? Being classical helps so much, especially for software development. If you're trying to prove something, in many cases, it's much easier. If, especially the communication with the automation helps a lot being classical. But we still care about, especially if you're using Lean as a programming language, you want to know what computes and what doesn't, right? Being classical is not the problem. I mean, the main problem is that if you use Hilbert choice, right? Hilbert choice, the axiom says, if exists some x, p of x, it allows you to choose the x that satisfies p. It's like a magic, right? From the programming point of view, it's just magic. You are saying that there is some x that satisfies p. You magically synthesize this x, right? This is the Hilbert choice, and you can use if you want. If you open the namespace classical in Lean, you're going to have access to Hilbert choice, right? But what happens? What happens is Lean is going to force you to mark the definition as non-computable, right? Because now there's no way to synthesize code for this function, right? This choice function in general, right? For special cases, we can, right? So in the manual, we describe cases where the choice is constructive, that you can do it. But in general, you cannot generate code for it, and you have to mark the definition as non-computable, right? And Lean is going to track. In this way, we think we achieve the best of both worlds, right? You can use classical logic, but everything that you want, you know exactly which definitions compute and which doesn't, right? For instance, it allows you to work with classical definition of real numbers that it will not compute, but it's useful in many scenarios, right? When you're talking, constructing models that you really don't want, you don't care if they compute or not, right? You can prove properties about models, right? And now when you're writing code, you're working with the constructive reals if you want, or floating point numbers, or whatever you want. And you can even now write theorems that relate the computable and the non-computable ones, prove some relationship between the model and the implementation. But you know exactly what computes and what doesn't. And I think for most software engineers, this is what matters. Nobody cares. At least 99%, I believe, of software developers don't care about constructive, the difference between classical and constructive. What they care is if the function they are writing computes or not. We like to say that we give the user freedom to trust, right? You have several dials in Lean. For instance, one dial, you can say, I trust that the imported modules are typed correct. I'm not going to retype check the imported modules every time I run Lean, right? I trust the imported modules. Of course, you can say, don't trust anything, right? It's the check everything. But you are not going to do that all the time, right? Maybe you do that once for a day or overnight. But you have this level of control. Lean also allows you to put semantic attachments. The semantic attachments allow you to speed up type checking and evaluation. But any, we call macro here, any macro should be, you should be able, when you define a new macro, you have to explain how to eliminate it, how to expand it into the in a term that is in the core language. You can assign trust level to macros, and you can use this level to specify which macros you are not trusting, which ones you are trusting, right? For instance, you can use the macros for using the GNU multi-precision arithmetic package. Probably GMP is a extensively used library, very efficient. It's much more efficient to compute big numbers using GMP than compute big numbers encoded using data structures in Coq or Lean, right? And you can, most of the time, you can say, I'm going to trust GMP. Once in a while, I'm going to expand into the native representation that's much more expensive.
So, sorry, there's a flag that just says, internally, every time you see a Z, use a GMP Z?
Yes, I know, it's slightly more complicated than that. I mean, is more when the decision procedures are doing calculations, they can use GMP, and in the proofs they create, instead of encoding the numbers using the natural encoding, I mean using binary numbers or using unary numbers, they encode them as GMP numbers that are macros. When you expand the macro, you get the one, the binary encoding or the unary encoding, right? But you can do all the computations using GMP. When you're checking the proofs and everything, you can use GMP. And you also want, I mean, another step, you can use macros, for instance, to encode all sorts of things. I mean, for instance, a set solver produces a resolution proof that's much more compact than when you compile this proof into dependence type theory primitives. Right? You can have a macro that checks a resolution proof for you. This resolution proof checker is a really small piece of code, but you are extending the trusted code base by including it. But in this way, instead of extending the kernel, you just create the macro. Now you can decide if you trust this extra checker or not, right?
Do you think in practice people will always do sort of both versions? I mean, it seems like it would be very tempting when somebody has the compact representation and a small checker for the compact representation, for them not to bother with the expansion to full dependent type.
Yes, this might happen, but I mean, this is, being able to expand is really important, especially when you want to call the reference type checker. You don't want the reference type checker to implement all these extensions, right? And if you're using GMP, GMP is a huge beast. You don't want to trust it also, probably.
I'm lost on a couple of things. So I think I understand the idea of importing modules and say, yes, I trust them.
Yes.
But it seems to me that that can be achieved with a foreign function interface plus what cop would just call admits. Mm-hmm. You know, I want to run this code and here's how I say it works, right?
Yeah.
And then there's this notion of macros for really extending the kernel, yes, in a declarative way. These, yes, seem like two totally different,
yes,
things.
Yes, exactly, they are, yes.
Okay.
Yes.
I retract the claim that I was confused.
Okay. We also have the feature, I mean, the main version of Lean can export everything you developed in Lean. We have a very simple format, right? So we have the API for this format on our GitHub webpage. I'm going to put these slides online. I mean, the links here, they work. I mean, if you click the link, you go to the webpage. You're going to find the documentation there. This is useful for communicating with other tools, right? People that are implementing reference type checkers, they implement these reference type checkers using this exporting capability, right? And we also have a C API and the Haskell API, right? The Haskell API was implemented on top of the C API. Right? And Lean was implementing C++. You have the C++ API too, of course. Okay, now let's talk a little bit about some features like the recursive equations compiler, right, that allow you to write Haskell-like codes that you do by cases, right, and Lean does all the compilation to the built-in primitives behind the scenes for you, right. This is just a basic example for the Fibonacci function, right. This compiler supports dependence pattern matching, right. Dependent pattern matching is quite convenient. Anybody that tries to define these functions without using this compiler, they will suffer a lot of pain. I mean, it's quite complicated to do by hand these definitions. And notice that the compiler takes care of unreachable cases, right? Both map and zip, they are operating on vectors of size n. Notice that I have only two cases instead of four. Right, because if the vectors have the same size, you know that the nil with cons and cons with nil are unreachable, and the compiler takes care of the unreachable cases. If you have a map that operates on three vectors, you still have need only two cases instead of eight. Right, there's a lot of magic going behind the scenes, I mean, in the compilation to make this look natural. And this is the way I think it should be, right? Nobody wants to bother with boilerplate code. Right? We like to believe that you have human readable proofs. Right? For instance, here we have a definition, we have this calculational proof style in Lean that's like a textbook proof where you have a chain of equalities. It doesn't need to be equality. It can be any relation that you can prove transitivity for, right? And basically, you have a sequence of steps where you, on the right-hand side, you explain why this step holds.
Right. So are those referring to limits, or those comments, or?
No. This is actually, this is a hint saying why, how to synthesize the proof term that shows that this step holds.
And are those like names of databases of lemmas? Or?
Yeah, these are lemmas, yes. Eventually, the ultimate goal is to not say anything, right? You just give the derivation and the system is responsible for synthesizing everything. Tactics are the gateway to automation, right? In Lean, we view the tactic framework is where you prepare the stage for invoking the automatic procedures like the ones you find in provers like Z-tree, right? You have combinators like any other proof assistant, right? There's nothing new here. Structures, right? Another compiler we have is to make it convenient for the user to define structures, right? You have some form of inheritance. You can like define a group is a monoid that has an inverse, right? And you can declare the extra fields here, right? You can claim your structures can be parametric. You can view them as parametric modules too, right? All the projections are generated automatically, right? Again, the structures are not part of the kernel. They are implemented outside. They are compiled on the kernel built-in primitives, right? And you can specify if a structure is a type class or not, right? The nice thing about structures is that, for instance, suppose that you define a ring that it is an additive commutative group, a monoid, and has distributivity, right? Something like you would find in a textbook, right? Ring is a structure that has the properties of additive commutative group, a monoid, and distributivity, right? Then the nice thing is that automation can adjust everything for you automatically behind the scenes. I mean, the automation is smart enough to use theorems that talk about monoids, theorems that talk about distributivity and additive commutative groups behind the scenes, right? You don't have to create copies of the theorems. You don't need to do anything like that. I mean, you don't need to create copies for each. As you you inherit a structure, you don't have to copy the theorems again, right? The automation is going to be able to figure out that it can use the theorems from monoids for rings automatically for you. And here you have a calculational proof that you are using automation to discharge each step. You're saying that, oh, you can prove each step using the simplifier. That's one of the automated procedures we have in Lean.
So sorry, when you do the structure ring,
yes.
How does it, I mean, I guess that I'm just a little bit confused about how the extends work. So it knows the operator for the ring is, there's a single operator and it's the same in all of those classes it's extending, or structures it's extending?
Yeah, basically, the times, for instance, the additive commutative group is a structure that has addition, right? That's why now you can write the plus. The times comes from the monoids, right? Monoids is a semi-group. Semi-group has a has multiplication. That's why now you can write the times.
So it just inherits those and doesn't need to.
Yes. The hierarchy is quite big. I think there's almost 100 structures.
So the extends defines the constructor for ring.
Yes.
And it takes an argument of a additive commutative group, a monoid, and a...
He gets all the fields, I mean, you
So the extends is defined the fields of the constructor?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. And he also defines coercions between... he creates functions for mapping rings into additive commutative groups, rings to monoids, and also the type class resolution that you can go from one to the other. Mm-hmm. All this is generated automatically. Here, for instance, it's showing how to create a semi-ring, right? how to show that, giving a S that is a ring, how to construct a semi-ring, right? We just set these two fields. We basically say, copy all fields from S that are common to semi-ring, and these two missing fields here, we proved the theorems here, and you set the mal zero fields and zero mal fields using these two proofs here. Basically, now you are setting all the fields of a semi-ring using the fields of a ring. You're showing how to go from a ring to a semi-ring. Basically, the idea is that you're showing that a ring, by definition, you're showing that ring is automatically, since it inherits, it is a monoid, it is a distributed structure. But you can add new relations, like you can say that define a function that shows how to map a ring to a semi-ring, right?
And will lean know to use that coercion automatically?
Yes, that's why. This is the meaning of this instance keywords is to tell you that to use this coercion automatically in the type class resolution. Right. And here's just a bigger example, right? He's just showing, for instance, is int A an additive group, right? If you follow the inheritance graph, you're going to say yes. The answer is yes, right?
What if there are multiple coercions possible? Does Lane do the search?
Yes, yes.
And, okay.
And we have also a flag for Lane to sign an error if there are two paths that are not definitionally equal, right? So more than one. There are non-trivial theorems that have already been proved in Lane, like this Zilov theorem from group theory, right? There's also I didn't mention here, but there's a huge library for homotopy type theory. People are now formalizing multivariate analysis. There's a lot of activity. I will talk a little bit now, the final part, just to give you a glimpse about automation in this joint work with Daniel Selson from Stanford. This is work in progress, right? But the automation in Lean is going to be a collection of procedures, right? Some of them you're going to we can find them in Z3 too, but here the main difference is that they have been adapted to dependence type theory, right? And one big thing that's important to have automation in a system like Lean is indexing, right? In Z3 we are facing problems that are undecidable. Some fragments are NP complete, the other fragments are XP time, but most of the time, the problem is quadratic behavior, right? Any square can kill you, and kills many, many times, right? Just if you're doing linear scans on the database of facts you have, you add a new fact, but that you scan everybody, right? Every new fact you add, you have to scan everything. You have this quadratic behavior that kills performance, and this happens all the time, right? And Lean is not an exception, right? And the default way to fight this behavior is to have indexing data structures, right? That allows you to find information efficiently. Okay, the first challenge we have in a system of Lean that there are different flavors, right? Are you constructive or classical, right? Is the first thing. Do you want to use semi-constructive axioms or not? Right? A semi-constructive axiom is like function extensionality, right? Most mathematicians believe in function extensionality, but some people want to prove things without assuming it, right? Are you proof relevant or proof irrelevant? Do you have a predicative property or not? You have all these different flavors of type theory. Should automation handle all combinations or not, right? This is one of the challenges. Another one is the dependence types, right? Even if you ignore, you try the best setting, like I'm classical, I'm going to assume all semi-constructive axioms, proofing relevance in predicative prop. This is the easiest setting for automation. You still have the dependence types that create a lot of problems. You also want to handle type classes, right? You have a semi-group, right? You want to be able to use this axiom in any structure that inherits from semi-group, right? You don't want to have copies for every structure that inherits from semi-group. You don't want a copy of this theorem, right? Okay, let's talk about the first one. I'm going to give only one example. It's congruence closure. I chose this example because congruence closure is in the kernel of almost every SMT solver. For sure, it's in the kernel of CVC4, MFSET, Yikes, and Z3, right? It's very efficient procedure for handling equality, right? Here I have a very simple example. The contrast is not really good. I mean, the first two here in red, I'm going to, animation of the execution. I'm handling now A equals B. The procedure is just going to merge the equivalence classes. Each circle here is an equivalence class. When you process the equality A equals B, you just merge the equivalence class of A with the equivalence class of B. Right? The union finds data structure allows you to implement that operation very efficiently. Right? Now you have B equals C, and when you process this equality, you merge the equivalence class of A, B with the equivalence class of C. Now you have a bigger equivalence class. And you keep processing the equalities. Now you merge D and E. You keep merging the equivalence classes. Each operation is very efficient. Eventually, you hit a disequality, right? A different from E. You just check now if A and E are in the same equivalence class. They are not, that's fine. There's nothing that's forcing A and E to be equal, right? In this way, you are fine. Then you check the next disequality. A should be different from S. Now you have, it's unsatisfiable because A and S are in the same equivalence class, and the invariant of this procedure is if two variables are in the same equivalence class, it means you can construct a proof that they are equal, right? By using transitivity, right, symmetry, you can build a proof, right? Because if two things are in the same equivalence class, there's a chain of inequalities that can force them to be equal. So this part, the congruence is not there yet. It's just handling the equalities. This is a very efficient procedure. The congruence closure comes because now you add this rule, right? The congruence rule. If the arguments of two function applications are equal, right? The result of the function application should be equal to, right? If x1 equals y1, x2 equals y2, and so on, right? Then you have that f of x1 to xn is should be equal to the result of f applied to y1 to yn. Right? The function, one function should return the same result if it gets the same arguments, right? The congruence closure procedure now, okay, we know how to handle the equalities. The next thing it's going to do is to enforce this rule, right? We have here D and E are in the same equivalence class, right? If they're in the same equivalence class, G of G and G of E should also be in the same equivalence class by congruence, right? That's what the procedure is going to do. It's going to keep enforcing the congruence rule. To do that, it's going to merge the equivalence class of GD and GE, right? And you keep that until you reach a fixed point, right? Now we have A and B in the same equivalence class, and G of G and G of E are in the same equivalence class too. In this way, the F of A, GD, and F of B, GE should also be in the same equivalence class. You go there and merge again. Right? And now you get an inconsistency, right? Because you have this disequality, right? You have a disequality saying that F of A, GD should be different from F of B, GE, but they are now in the same equivalence class. Then the problem is unsatisfiable. That's essentially what the congruence closure procedure does. The only thing, the tricks, why the implementation is not super small is because you have the indexing data structures for doing these operations efficiently. You want to be able to backtrack efficiently because congruence closure is not the only procedure that is being executed. There is a case analysis going on behind the scenes. You have to implement all these extra features that add complexity. But conceptually, is a simple thing, right? And congruence closure for and heuristic instantiation, right, are two workhorses in SMT, right? For many applications of Z3, people don't even use arithmetic. If you're a Daphne user, everything you the features you use in Z3 are arithmetic, that I didn't talk about, congruence closure, and heuristic instantiation and case analysis. You are using only that. I explain congruence closure here, right? But with these four features, you cover everything you have been doing. If Daphne can be covered with these four features implemented in Z3. But heuristic instantiation, just the combination of congruence closure and heuristic instantiation is already powerful and allows you to prove many theorems. I will have some examples later. Okay, is it, in principle, it looks like going to dependency type theory should not create any problem, right? We have equality in dependency type theory, right? This symbol A equals B is just a notation for EQ AB. Basically, you are saying that you have equality between elements of type A, right? You can, for the equality in Koch, Lin, Agda, you can prove this congruence axiom, right? You have two functions f and g, a that's the type is a to b. If you have a and b of type a, and now you have a f equals g, a equals b, then f of a equals g of b, right? This can be easily proved in Koch, Lin, Agda, right? All these systems based on the dependence type theory, this theorem, this lemma can be proved. The first challenge is when you have dependence types. Suppose that I have a function f, that the result type depends on the input arguments, right? Now you already have problems. F of a equals f of b is not even type correct because they have different types. F of a is going to have type b of little a, and f of b is going to be type b of little b, right? So f of a equals f of b is not even type correct, right? You can try to address this issue using a typecasting operation, right? Since if you have a proof that A equals B, then you can write the equality. So this term here is provable, right? You have to use a typecast to write F of A equals G of B, right? You cannot write it directly. You need a cast because it makes sense because you have a proof that A equals B. And you can use this proof as a typecast, right? But the problem now, you have to do congruence closure, modulo casts, is very complicated because you're going to have these casts everywhere, right? Okay. There's another alternative. There's something called, in type theory, called heterogeneous equality, where you can equate elements of different types, right? You have here A and B, not necessarily have the same type. That's why it's called heterogeneous equality. For instance, you can write this theorem here. This is fine. There is one, to go to heterogeneous to homogeneous, you may expect that if A and B have type A and you have equality between them, it would be natural to go to a homogeneous case. But it turns out that this doesn't hold. This is not provable, right? You need the principle of unique identity proofs, right? But if you want to use heterogeneous equality, you need the UIP. Because if even you want to use heterogeneous equality temporarily and eventually go back to homogeneous case, right? But to go back to the homogeneous case, you have UIP. Heterogeneous equality is used in many projects, right? In the comp search projects, if you go there, you're going to find heterogeneous equality there, right? And they assume an axiom that implies UIP, right? They don't assume directly UIP, but assume something that implies UIP, right? And so it's not, this is the kind of axiom that is assumed in many real real verification projects, right, that have been used all over the place, assume this axiom. It's not a big deal to assume it, right? The next problem is that this theorem here is not provable. I'm finishing up. This theorem here is not provable in dependence type theory, right? You think that it's supernatural to expect that if F is heterogeneously equal to G and A is heterogeneously equal to B, then F of A would be heterogeneously equal to G of B. This is not provable in dependence type theory, right? But fortunately, there is a family of theorems that are congruence theorems. The restriction is you need a homogeneous equality on the functions. The arguments can be heterogeneously equal, but the functions should be homogeneously equal. And you can create for functions of any arity an instance of this H conger n, right? And our congruence procedure works for any instance. It dynamically creates instances of this theorem behind the scenes for the user. But the nice thing is that using congruence closure, automating induction, and heuristic instantiation, we can prove in Lean theorems like this one, reverse of reverse V, right, where V is a vector AN, right, is equals to V automatically, right? Or the reverse of appends is the append of the reverses. These theorems to prove by hands are really tricky because of the casting, all the casting you have to do, right? And this can be proved automatically, right? Notice that here I have to use heterogeneous equality because the types here are different, right? You have, in one case, you have the type is n plus m, right? In the other case, you have the type is m plus n, is inverted, right? And so you have to choose a typecasting, right? That's why you have the heterogeneous equality here. But behind the scenes, the congruence closure algorithm can take care of everything. And I think this is the level that a human wants to interact with the system, right? People ask, okay, you're using the UIP, but the hot mode is proof relevant and inconsistent with the unique of identity proofs, right? If you're using homotopy type theory, the UIP, you cannot assume UIP, right? Yes, the previous solution is not going to work if you want to work on homotopy type theory. We have many, there's no general solution so far, but we have many custom congruence theory, many special cases we can do congruence closure for homotopy type theory. Right? I'm not going to go into the details, but I'm happy to talk offline the cases we can cover. But we still, it's not as general as for standard modes Lean, but we can do congruence closure also for in the homotopy type theory modes. Future work, we want to do more automation. We want to have more efficient evaluator for Lean terms, an efficient interpreter. We want to have code generators for Lean, right? We are constantly implementing better libraries, right? There are many people at CMU and Stanford writing libraries for Lean, right? They are working now on multivariate analysis, right? I'm going to here finish with some links. I mean, Lean is hosted on GitHub, right? All the source code is available there. We have interactive tutorial that you don't need. You can play with Lean without installing Lean on your machine. You can just go there and play with it. I mean, there are many chapters. It's based on the lecture notes for the Type 3 course at CMU. Thank you very much.
I think there might be a few people who have to run, so if they need to sneak out, go ahead. But yeah, I think if there are any questions for Leo about Lean.
Yeah, so do you have any like comparison how your performance compares to Carl?
No, there's no, it's not like SMT that everybody has the same input format and it's easy to compare, right? Would be like a random guess. I mean,
what about anecdotally, like from the user's perspective, does it feel like, I don't know, does it feel like it's faster?
Well, I have some users that, for instance, some Coq users came to me saying that you were impressed that the demo, they thought we had a background process running in the background. It was not. It was running all the time, it's calling the Lean process from scratch and doing everything.
I think that's a polite way of saying it's way faster.
But of course, the issues like the complexity of your development. I mean, I don't want to make this kind of claim. Yeah.
So this whole proof of validation thing is pretty exciting. What do you see as the future direction of that? Do you think?
Well, there's a lot to be done there, right? I mean, we managed to do the first building block of SMT solver. That's the congruence closure module, right? The next step is to add arithmetic, right? But we don't want to implement arithmetic like we have done in Z3, that is fixed, hard-coded for integers and real numbers. We want to do it parametric. I mean, we're going to have automation that works for rings, automation that works for ordered fields, real algebraic fields. We want to make it generic in such a way that you prove some structure is a ring, you can use the automation for this structure. That's the direction we want to go. There's also, I didn't talk a lot about it, but Daniel Selson is actually into machine learning. He wants to use machine learning techniques to like guess relevant theorems, guess the next step in your proof, to make the system more predictable. All this brittleness that we have in Z3, because it's just doing blind search, brute force, to try to do something like what a mathematician would prove, right? Because one of the challenges, like in Z3, he doesn't respect abstraction layers, right? A tool like Z3 breaks everything to pieces in reason, in use brute force, right? But if you want to deal with complexity, you want to respect the abstraction layers. But there are some theorems that even a human mathematician would break the abstraction layer to be able to prove the theorem. This is the kind of thing that should we break or not the abstraction layer. Like, for humans, find it really easy to decide when to break, but it's really hard to automate, and that's one thing Daniel wants to use machine learning to decide when to do it.
Okay, well, let's thank the speaker again, and that wraps up the first Pulse Seminar External Speaker. So, yeah, see you all next time.